welcome back. You know when you hear that music, something good is right behind it. I think today might be something great. I am super excited to get our friend Elaine Spector on the calendar. We met Elaine at the beginning of the pandemic. She lives up north. Her firm decided to engage ours, and from that point on, we've been friends. I love following her story. She means so much to so many people. Elaine Spector, it's your chance to tell us something good.
Well, there's a lot that's good lately. Thank you for having me, Steve. We have been on this mission with Steve for branding our law firm. And I can tell you that we benefited firsthand from going from the pandemic and no posting to what we've done. And it's really a way to get out there things that we're already passionate about, things that we already have a thirst for. And for us and for me, it's been diversity in law. And we've seen some huge strides in that area. And I'd love to talk about that some more.
Yeah. So, one of the things we teach, and you just nailed it, is that whatever you're passionate about, people buy people. And so you attract people inbound based on who you are, not what you do. And right from the day we met, you were very vehement that not only yourself, but the whole firm was committed to diversity in law. And I was like, well, what do you mean? And you sort of unpacked that for me. So the education is great. So my question to you is, what does diversity in law mean? And what are you guys doing about it?
Absolutely. So there's diversity in law, and there's no question that the legal profession is one of the least diverse professions in the United States. And when you look at patent law, which is where I specialize, where you have to sit for a patent bar, you have to have a hard science degree. So that's in engineering or biology or chemistry. My background's in mechanical engineering. So you take that legal profession that's not really that diverse, and then you narrow it even further because now we have a hard science that's required. So our firm did a study to analyze the statistics with regard to diversity of the patent bar, and we found that not only are women underrepresented, but racially diverse women are sorely underrepresented. In fact, there are more practitioners registered to practice for the United States Patent and Trademark Office that have the name Michael than there are racially diverse patent practitioners.
Really? Wow.
Yes.
That is insane.
It's insane.
Crazy.
So once we found that statistic, and there's about 50,000 registered practitioners. We acquired data with regard to about half of the registered patent bar and analyzed that and just found that statistic to be just really scary.
Yeah, I totally agree. So let's give some backdrop. You're a partner at Harrity and Harrity. My first call was with John Harrity, who actually described himself as an engineer that became an attorney, which means that he's a nerd. So yeah. It was like fantastic. I then proceeded to meet you guys. You were already passionate about this cause. It wasn't something that you made up to put in social media. So The fact that you were really into it, what have you done since the time that we've met? Because I know the advancements you guys have made. I want you to talk about your incubator program. Mm-hmm. Give us some meat on the bone about it's not just talk. You live it and breathe it.
Absolutely. So I joined the firm about 5 years ago. And right away, I delved into our diversity committee. And our first initiative that I worked on was our Harrity for Parity Women's Patent Workshop. Women account for only 20% of the patent bar. So that was my first, as being a woman, that was the first group I wanted to tackle. And so we have a week-long workshop and we have prominent female patent attorneys come speak. We even had the Rocky Mountains offices, USPTO regional director come and speak as well as partners at firms, in-house people as well, to help these women provide connections and get them excited about a career in IP. We also started the Harrity Academy, which is free online training for diverse patent practitioners or people who want to become patent practitioners. you know, with our profession, there's a steep learning curve in learning how to draft patent applications, and no firms really teach you how to do it. And so Harrity, we really have an amazing training program, and that's kind of our give back, help provide these free training programs to diverse patent practitioners so that they can build their skill set to succeed in a very tough career. And then we did the Minority Firm Incubator, which you know about as well. And we wanted to help give the tips and tools that John and Paul Harrity have with respect to starting their own firm. Like, they started their firm 23 years ago, just the two of them. And they have now built their firm, and we're growing kind of exponentially. We're up to maybe 44 practitioners now. I joined when there was 14. And he wants to get back and provide those tools of how to build your business. Just not just writing patent applications. How are you running the business? How are you hiring superstars? How are you doing the business development? They have 42 weeks that are dedicated to teaching minority-owned firms how to really optimize their businesses. And then we have some other initiatives, but the one I'm super, super excited about is our Patent Pathways program. So Steve, you know that statistic I shared about the racially diverse women. With that statistic in mind, we launched our Patent Pathways program. And so we wanted to focus on the least represented group of patent bar, Black women. And we wanted to pay for the patent bar prep. And, you know, these review courses cost a couple $1,000s, pay for their patent bar review prep, pay for the fees to sit for the patent bar, provide training to, you know, again, develop that skill set to be an effective practitioner. And then we got 20 law firms to sign up to interview these candidates and offer at least a 1-year position to them to give them the experience to, again, not only become a patent practitioner, but to continue developing as a patent practitioner.
I, from the minute I met you, was fascinated by this. You know that. So I have a couple of questions. The first one is, why you? You know, like, you know, you're very successful at what you do. You can go about your business and be great at it. You're in, you're a partner, you've reached success. What's in it for you? Why would you and the firm commit to this?
Well, I think what's in it for me is part of the journey for me when I first entered this practice. So my first job was in Bethesda at a firm with four other patent attorneys, all white men, married, they have families. And I'm this young 24-year-old woman kind of thrown into this profession. And just a funny story is that I didn't really have a lot in common with these men, but I wanted to be part of the gang. And so I tried to learn tools to help myself succeed in that profession. And so we would go to lunch and they'd start talking politics and sports. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't know who they're talking about. Who's Trent Lott? Well, I started ordering the Washington Post and then started reading it so that I could be included in the conversation. They weren't really interests of mine, but I'm like, you know, I'm just going to get myself up to speed so I don't feel left out. So it's kind of that attitude of saying, hey, I don't feel like I have a lot in common with everyone here, but I'm going to do what it takes to be included and to succeed and to be persistent. And so I think it's that attitude that's kind of helped me stay in the profession and kind of propel along and making such that diversity is now, I know what women who are entering the profession think of what they have to do. And so if I can eliminate some of that difficulty I had in those first, you know, 10 to 20 years, so be it. Because there's a lot more flexibility now, Steve, than there ever was. I mean, I have more stories about all that.
What a fabulous answer. I think other, you know, categories, other professions can take what you guys have done and sort of mirror it, because there's a lot of businesses that are struggling with the same thing, is how do I break through that good old boys club? So let's switch gears. So you have this platform, you have this message, you guys embrace social media and social media training more than anybody I've dealt with in a long time. You guys said, we don't know any of this stuff, but if you can teach us, we'll do it. Absolutely. And you guys took to it like anybody. So how has your life changed because of social media? I know the answer. I know your daughter has, but share with the audience, the lifestyle effect it's had on you, because this is the reason why the world has changed.
So it's had a huge impact as far as branding for our firm, as far as recognizing us as leaders in the diversity space. People, it's funny, people recognize me. I almost feel like a star in some ways, because they're like, oh, I see your post. And it's so many times people will say, I love your posts about diversity. I love what you post about. I love seeing about your family. And it's actually, and I know Steve, you know this, it provided a vehicle in which for people to understand what we're really doing in the diversity space. So I'm involved in a lot of organizations, but again, when I can flesh out the details of what we're doing through our diversity efforts, through LinkedIn, people really understand the impact that we're having. I do weekly vlogs on LinkedIn that talk about diversity issues in the legal field. I might even talk about pay equity and in all fields, of course, any issues that relate to women. And I can say what's really interesting, and for the young lawyers who happen to watch this, is that, you know, earlier in my career, when I was having a family, I was juggling when my kids were really young, you know, I had to deal with a lot of those work-life issues. And now that my kids are a little bit older, I can lean more into my career. And working with you helped provide that platform for me, such that, again, I'm leaning into a lot of things. I'm leaning into leadership roles. I'm leaning into some work I'm doing with a nonprofit. I'm not now a president. And my 15-year-old daughter, and I don't know if y'all have like teenage daughters, they're not the most complimentary at times. But she said to me the other day, she said, "Mom, like, when did you start running everything?" And she said, "Mom, you slay. You slay." I mean, if anyone says you slay, that's...
I don't know what that means.
Yeah, you slay. Like, I guess, you know, that's their slang for like, you rock. You rock. She goes, "You're my model." And she's never said that before. So that's been really exciting.
So it's neat, because life changed. Some people changed with it. Some people are still trying to hang on. You guys went from office-based to home-based. So you work exclusively at home now, correct?
100%.
So talk to me about this work-life balance thing that, you know, people seem to try and get their arms around. But when you're passionate, everything is, you know. So talk to me, but, you know, from your view.
So I understand during the pandemic for families that had small children, it was a totally different scenario than it was for me having teenage kids. They were self-sufficient. But I had young kids, and I was able to work out some flexibility with prior positions where I would work from home or work reduced hours. When you do that, though, you lose advancement opportunities. And so I had to step back a little bit to try to be with my kids. I live in Baltimore, and I had to commute to DC. That's terrible commute. That's 2 hours each way. I only did it a couple days a week, but it just was so overwhelming for me. If I would have been able to work from home full time back then, I could have stayed in the profession full time. I'd have more flexibility to be a sane person when I'm home with my kids, instead of worrying about that commute. I don't want to spend all those hours in the car. And we know at Harrity, because we're fully remote, I was hired remotely 4-5 years ago before the pandemic, that actually I think I'm a better lawyer at home than I am in the office, because I can exercise. I don't have to waste my time sitting in a car frustrated with traffic. I'm a nicer person. I think it was a game changer for my family. And I think they will all agree to that when I was able to start working from home 5 years ago, it changed everything. But one great benefit of the pandemic is that all places were forced to allow their employees to work from home, and almost saw, although they're kind of trying to refute it now, that they were just as productive, if not more productive. That first month at home, we had our highest billing month ever, because we weren't messing around with commutes and running around. We were working. So
I love hearing it and digesting it, knowing full well that when we started working together, this was all, you were one of the people who stood up and go, I don't want to talk about my family. I don't want to put this stuff out there. So talk to me about overcoming fear, because you've done it in your career, but when it came to this specifically, and this is the reason why I'm bringing it up, is every single person we work with, it's brand new. It was a new way to communicate on things that you normally wouldn't communicate. And while you talk about the law firm and you talk about, you know, diversity, you talk about you, like, I can't wait to come up and get some of that cooking. So, that Greek cooking. So talk to me about overcoming fear.
So you're 100% right. When you first told us that we could post about our family on LinkedIn, there is that natural hesitancy because you think, oh, you believe, you buy into that talk that LinkedIn is just a platform for professionals who don't have lives. I mean, we can only post about professional articles and we can't include anything about ourselves. And what I learned from you, when I got a little courage to do my first post, and I don't know if you remember my first post, but I sent it to you. It was my 20-year anniversary. It was a picture of me and my husband. My husband's Jewish, and we were doing the traditional dance where we were thrown up in these chairs, and I had asked the caterer to make sure there were armrests so I could grip those in my satin dress so I wouldn't fall. And the music started, and I look for the chair, and there's no armrest. So I'm like, oh God, I'm holding on for dear life on the bottom of my chair. And the photographer, God bless his heart, got this great picture of me holding on in fear, and my husband just leaning back and, like, you know, has that handkerchief and just throwing around, and he's almost falling off. And I'm looking at him like, are you for real? And that's, it was just a funny post about our relationship and just life with him and how he's just more that laid back. And I'm like, what is he doing now?
The vulnerability that you showed in posting that, I mean, that's a real emotion that you had, that you said, okay, I'll take your word for it, Steve. I'll share that emotion. And that, I think, is a gift of life. It changes your life, not about social media, not about followers, not about, you know, likes and all that crap. I think it changes your life because it changes how you communicate. You're letting people know who you are, which is the fruit of how we live as human beings. We are communicators.
100%. And I can't tell you how many times people will comment on a post, a personal post, and say, even if it might not be on the LinkedIn feed, they'll send me an in message or reach out to me or text me and say, well, that really, like, meant a lot. Like I feel that too. I've been through that. And so I think, again, people connect on these vulnerabilities, and I think it's a good thing to show. It reveals something about who I am. And I want my clients to know who I am. I want them to know the personal side of me, because I'm not just this patent attorney with a mechanical engineering degree that can do their work. I'm a human being, a mother, a person. And I want my clients to know that.
It's awesome. It's so great. I mean, you were such a great student. I mean, literally digesting it and coming up with your own comfort level. But now that we're talking about you, you would be perceived as a very successful, you know, woman in leadership. What does it take to be a great leader? What does it take? What are the takeaways that you could share with somebody who's watching this that says, if you could do these 3 to 5 things, where is the focus?
So I think what's allowed me to move into leadership roles has been saying yes and stepping up, like not letting fear take over you. So I've been working with a nonprofit organization for 5 or 6 years. And they asked me to be president. And I thought, gosh, I've never been president of anything. Like, how am I going to run this thing? And so it's getting over that fear, that kind of imposter syndrome. Like, I've never done that before. So it's having the courage to say yes. And it's also just volunteering and getting the job done. My personality type, and I post about this on LinkedIn, is INTJ. Like, I am the doer. I'm getting it done. And they say INTJs are not, they don't seek leadership roles, but we tend to be elected into leadership roles because we get the job done. We have this ability to work with people, but also follow through with what, you know, what the projects are. So I think it's that saying yes, having more time to say yes. And one thing leads to the next. Like, as we build our network, you know, or you know it, you know, as you build your network, it's our net worth. And as I meet someone else and they introduce me to someone else and I'm asked to do this, and then they ask me to do this, you know how it works. It's in a circle. So when you start saying yes to this, you're opening up the doors and connections to something else. Building those connections are super important to moving into these positions, because they're going to bring your name up when you're not in the room. They'll say, oh, you know, I have someone for this. This person has been, you know, really, you know, they're really focused on, like for me, and focused on diversity, and they've got some great programs. Let's ask her. She wants to speak. So I think that's really been the big difference from when I started Harrity 5 years ago, because I was stepping back in. It was good timing for me to say, I've got a little more time and I'm not in the weeds with these young ones. And what can I do to make a difference? Not just work-wise, but, you know, make a difference in our profession.
So it's so interesting when you say that, you know, your type doesn't normally volunteer, you get elected. And I'm going to tell you why, is because everybody else sees something that you don't see yourself.
That's probably right.
Part of the journey with you, coaching you and watching you explode, was just so much fun, because I saw it right from the start. You had the personality, you had the passion, you had the heart. You didn't see that. Now you're getting confirmation and validation all the time, and not that we recommend you do it for those reasons. But that's, you know, clearly you've been elected into this leadership role of, you can make a difference in women's lives.
Yeah.
So my last question to you is, if people want to contact you and have a conversation, whether they're in legal or in accounting or in any product or service business, are you open to it, and how do they find you?
So I'm going to say, you can find me on LinkedIn, connect with me, and write a personal message and say you saw me on Steve Nudelberg's Tell Me Something Good podcast. And I'm happy to set up a chat with you, a video chat, and we can just touch base about law or diversity, or just catch up. So that's the best way to reach me.
You guys are special people doing special things. You know, all of you have a special place in our heart. We were just on the phone with Sandy and John last week doing more charity work. So whatever I can do, whatever On the Ball can do for you forever, it's fun following you. I love seeing your kids look at schools and doing all the things you're doing. So congratulations. Thanks for spending some time with us, because that was definitely something good.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Steve, for having me.
Tell me something.